I have pushed the recording button, and we'll start this very informally, because this is going to be Ham Radio Now, episode 188, and that's Rich Casey, N5CSU over there. But I need some help, Rich. I don't know what to title this one. I don't know what we're going to do.
Well,
this is your show.
Let's call it the Internet and Ham Radio.
The Internet and Ham Radio. Sounds good. Last time, if you remember from last time, everyone, we were going to do this in a one-hour show. It was going to be a half hour or so worth of just trotting down memory lane, and then a half hour of this stuff, and we went 2 hours on trotting down memory lane. Right. We stepped on your football game. I hope you got to see some of that.
Not so good. Cowboys are out of it.
Yeah, Dallas, it was going to be Dallas and Green Bay, and Green Bay beat Dallas. And then the Seahawks beat Green Bay.
Right.
And then which made you feel better, I guess, some. And then the Patriots beat the Seahawks.
The very last minute. That was a great game.
Hey, well, it was an interesting game. There was a commercial I meant to bring up. Let me see if I can find that. Talk to the audience for a minute while I work on this.
Okay. Well, I was going to say, if you guys are ham radio, guys and gals are ham radio operators, and you want a great wallpaper for your intro page, do a Google on Schlitz beer and ham radio, and you will see the coolest drawing painting from back, I guess, in the 50s or early 60s, and I have that on my entrance screen on my iPad. Very cool.
Well, okay, so I'll take a look at that.
There first. You go.
Wow.
That's pretty cool.
Okay, so here's the thing that I was going to look for. It's called Michael and Son Super Bowl. Commercial. Michael and Son is a regional heating, plumbing, air conditioning stuff. And so most of the country did not see this commercial. And in fact, they ran several. Let's see. They ran.
Hello, Americans. Our critical infrastructure is at risk. We will not go quietly into the night.
They had this Obama impersonator.
Without a fight. I've always said, yes, we can. Oops. But today, we can't.
Not a bad impersonator. And Son, the Michael and Son's tagline that everybody hears all the time is, if you can't, we can. This. Yeah. But that's not the commercial I want to show you. Let's see if... stop it. Go away. There's a shorter one. There was a 5-second one, and I'm not finding it right now.
My fellow Americans, our critical...
One of the things you're going to discover is, as I work with all this stuff, is that I don't have full control over anything I do. I'm not very competent at this stuff. I'm not finding it. Tell you what, audience, I'll find it and I'll edit it in. And now I'll make an edit and I'll describe what it was for you. It's just a guy, one of their service techs, and he is pumping up a football.
If you can, we can. Michael and Son.
Ouch.
Yes, I don't think that they have any outlets in New England. I know that they go as far as Washington, D.C., because I saw some comments on YouTube about it from people up there, but I don't think they go to New England. But that, to me, and it was only regional, so not everybody in the country saw it, but now you've seen it. Assuming I can find it on YouTube, was the best commercial on the Super Bowl.
That's quite interesting because when several years ago, before Twitter was such a big thing, it was pretty cool to watch the commercials and then rate them. And the every year that built up more and more to where now it's a pretty big opportunity for the ad agencies to see how they're doing and for the public to vote immediately on the commercials. So fun stuff.
Yep. I'm not a big sports fan. You know, I like watching the Super Bowl. I may watch a game or two. When I was in Chicago, I watched the Bears a little bit more. But not a big sports fan, but the Super Bowl is fun. And for me, it's about 50% commercials and 50% the actual game. And this was a pretty good game. I thought it was a pretty good run of commercials, but I've seen critics say now this is a terrible year for commercials.
I thought there were some great ones.
Yeah, I did too. People were saying there were too many heartstring commercials.
Right, yeah, because Budweiser and the dog.
Yeah, well, there were a bunch of them, and I agree that some of them were not that great. I like the one of with the girls, Run Like a Girl.
Like a Girl, yeah. I thought that really was
that touched me.
The most impressive, and I was thinking about it a couple of days later, looking at all the lists, and it didn't make the top 5 or top 10, and I didn't understand why. I thought that was really neat.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about internet.
You want to do a show? I wanted to tell people why they haven't seen anything since almost the last time we did this. The only thing that's been on in between was the show with Gerald Youngblood, K5SDR, the CEO of Flex Systems, which is just down the road from you, right? Flex is in Austin.
I did not know that.
Yeah, they're in Austin, Texas.
Yeah, Texas, everything's not fairly close. You know,
they're 2 times. Relatively close. One day drive to Austin, yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, I drove past your house practically on my way down there for the DCC last September. You're a Tapper member, and I don't remember seeing you at the DCC.
I've never gone, but I've been a Tapper member for years and years, since the early days of Packet.
Did you know it was just going to be down the road from you?
No.
Okay. You're not paying careful attention.
Oh, sorry.
Would you have gone had you known it was just down in Austin?
Yeah. Yeah, I actually would have. I think that... presentations look really interesting. A lot of it's still over my head, but that's part of the deal. A Tapper is pushing ahead in front of everybody else.
Yeah. Well, of course you can watch them all on Ham Radio Now.
That's what I say.
Yep. And so that was the last episode that we put up. What happened was I took a ski trip with my lovely wife, Cindy, out to Salt Lake City, Utah, and had a great time for a week and came back, and on the airplane on the way back, got infected. Probably that's when I got infected, because the cold that I ended up with appeared. We were on the airplane on Saturday, and the cold pretty much appeared on Monday. So you know that's the time it takes for that stuff to get into your system. And then so all this past week I've had a cold, and right now you can probably hear some of it in my voice, and it's probably going to continue to get worse as the show goes on. But I'll do my best, and it'll slowly be leaving. And once it's left, I will be left with a hacking cough for about 3 weeks, which is worse to me than the cold is.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's why nothing's been going on here. And so now, without further ado, you don't have any ado, do you?
They're in the other room.
Okay, because I'm completely out of ado. So without further ado, here's Rich and Ham Radio and the Internet. It's all yours.
Okay. Well, first of all, I wanted to say, believe it or not, ham radio was very, very early in the internet. If you call up a graphic of the blocks, the original building blocks of the internet, the class A and class B IP addresses, you'll find something called APRN.net. And that stands for Amateur Radio Packet Network, packetradio.net. Make sure I say it, AMPR net. Look at that on Wikipedia and you'll get some of the background. Ham radio is actually assigned 44.128.0.0, which I think is a million IP addresses. So we were very, very early into this thing called the internet. For those folks that have been around from the beginning, when we started with the Hayes modem, the 300 baud modem, that actually Hayes was a ham, and there was a setting inside that box where you could send CW. So you could send a CW ID if you were sending 300 baud packet over the radio. And one of the guys that you should remember, Gary, if those brain cells are still burning, is a guy named Randy Seuss. And he was the ham in Chicago, the V9 GPM, if I remember his call right.
You do.
He and another guy, Ward Christensen, invented the computer bulletin board system, CBBS, back in the early 80s. Supposedly during a snowstorm, they got it working for cash, the Chicago Catch, the Chicago Area Computer Hobbyist Exchange. And it was a dial-in online 300 baud bulletin board service, which took on sort of a life of its own. Bulletin boards went crazy. We had them on ham radio. We had them where you dial in and use them. And when the internet came, they kind of usurped that idea. And that's where forums and the two-way exchange and Yahoo groups and all this stuff all is begat from that CBBS idea from the early 80s. So ham radio has been involved with the internet since right in there with Al Gore, I guess.
I guess I'm not surprised, but I didn't really know it. What year did you start tinkering with this stuff?
I was working at a company called E-Systems in the early 80s, which became Raytheon later. And we had a very early domain, ESY.com. E-Systems was a defense company and working with DARPA. And so they were very early users. So I think I was one of about a half a dozen people that had an email address, rcasey@esy.com. And so kind of tinkered around. There wasn't much on there if you weren't doing a Defense Department business back then. But I got my 300 baud modem as soon as I could. I got my first computer was a TRS-80 4K Model 1 from the RIP Radio Shack. I borrowed a Silent 700 printer.
You say RIP Radio Shack because it's fairly new news. Probably everybody, every ham knows, but just in case. Radio Shack.
Yeah. They did declare bankruptcy this past week, and they're closing a whole bunch of stores very quickly. I understand everything in the stores is going to be sold off in the store. So if you've got one near you, stop by and say hi to the manager and then grab what you wanted, maybe 50% off, and then hopefully help them find a better job somewhere else when the stores close. Apparently Sprint's going to take over some of the stores, but we'll see what happens.
Yeah, it's going to be sad. I don't frequent Radio Shack enough to keep them in business. I only go for the things that they have that nobody else does, but that's what their value was to me, parts and, you know, occasional component that they would have that that nobody else would around the area. To pick it up today, you can order all that stuff on the internet and get it in a day or so. But
technology built them, and technology is killing them, because you can pretty much Google anything you need and have it delivered. If you're on Amazon Prime, you can have it delivered sometimes next day. But I just used it Friday. Needed a cable to hook up my dad's new flat screen, and looked on the list yesterday, and indeed that store is closing this week. So it's going to be, you're going to have to go to the internet to get your stuff, or if you're in a major metro area, you know, go to Fry's or something like that.
I'm jealous about Fry's.
A big deal here is Ham Radio Outlet is opening its first Texas store, just opened this week in a suburb of Dallas, Plano.
Oh, no kidding.
So we're kind of, we're losing Radio Shack and gaining HRO.
That ought to help some. The closest one to me is Atlanta or Woodbridge or something near Washington D.C. in Virginia, and they're both a day's drive away. So, you know,
yeah,
you're not just gonna.
Fry's is an interesting story. You know, I started out as a grocery store, I guess, in California, and they had Munchies and a couple of surplus computer boards that somebody brought in, and then slowly but surely the Munchies got moved to the corner and the computer stuff grew and grew. So, you know, when you're waiting in line at Fry's, there's still about three aisles of junk food for sale, which is kind of a kick.
Yeah, I've been to Fry's in Las Vegas, in California, and outside of Atlanta. That's the closest Fry's, too, down in Atlanta. And it's always been pretty awesome. I mean, they're really junky stores, but they've got some amazing stuff. I need to have everybody say hello to the mouse, because every once in a while, thanks, mouse. A cat shows up. I'll put the mouse up here. She's not going to stay very long, but once in a while she stays for a good long time. All right, so we've tripped down memory lane again, and it's time to go back to your project. By the way, I brought up this web page for the AmperNet. Is that what's there of it today?
Yeah, and I don't know how much of that is really still active.
I know the guys at Tapper were talking about using the 44 domain for a lot of stuff, and occasionally you'd find hams that were not using the 44 domain for theoretically ham radio stuff, and the guys at Tapper were going, shame on you. Don't you know about our 44, and we need to keep it active.
Yeah, you wouldn't even know about it, though, in case somebody didn't tell you. I couldn't remember the number. I had to look it up this morning to see what the IP range was. But I know when I first I learned about TCP/IP because I wanted to put a bulletin board system on the air here in Dallas back in the early 80s and in the very early 80s, and I wasn't on the Internet yet. So when we started doing Ethernet at the office, I realized I already knew this stuff from ham radio, which is pretty cool. But anyway, a couple of general things. Of course, everyone knows change your passwords. But the other thing is there's a thing called two-factor authentication. And the idea is that it takes something you know, which is your password, and something you have, typically your cell phone. And most of the major websites enable you to turn two-factor authentication on. Please do that. It just takes a couple minutes. Grab your cell phone. Start with an easy one like Google or a website that you use all the time. If you want to find out more about it, just Google two-factor authentication to find out how it works. But what that does is it does give you an additional layer of protection for systems that you use and have an account on. If someone tries to hack your account, they're going to have your phone also, which typically you're not going to lose your phone too often anyway.
Yeah, so if I understand how that works, and I have it on a few things, when you want to go make a significant change, like changing your password, they say, okay, yes. Hang on a second, we're going to send you a code on your phone, and your phone lights up with the code, and they say, okay, now you got to plug that code in, proving that you are the person making that change, and not somebody who's hacked your site and trying to take over.
Exactly.
So, yeah, I got that going on a few things.
Of course, if you're doing online banking, look in the alert section and you can have yourself send an email anytime you make any use of your debit card or your credit card. And I've got that turned on. Within about a minute or two, you get a notification that your finances have just changed and hopefully you know about it. But that two-factor authentication, and a lot of the websites we're talking about have introduced it, especially in the last few months. So when you set up an account, if you haven't, please do that. If you're already a user, please think about doing it. So first thing, I've used a bunch of different mail systems. I've really preferred Gmail. We're going to start with some general tools and then talk ham radio. I use Gmail. I like the way it works. I like that I can keep my emails going back for years. You can find something just by putting in a keyword. But what I really want to talk, Google has a lot of other tools that folks don't know about. If you're in Gmail or if you just go to Google up in the upper right, you're going to see a little an icon with a bunch of there it is, 12 little squares up in the upper right. And if you click on that, that's going to give you, there you go, that's going to give you some tools. And then if you click on more there, you're going to see that there's actually a whole bunch more tools that they allow you to use. And I think you can take that to full screen.
I wouldn't know how.
Okay. I know you can do it from Gmail. I'm not sure if you use Gmail or not.
Oh, even more from Google. Yeah, maybe that's it there.
Yeah, there you go. Okay. There you go. There's your tool. There's a whole bunch of tools there that are available free to play with, see if they'll help you out. The one that I use the most, though, is not on there. I haven't quite figured out why. But I use Google Alerts a lot. And the easiest way I've found to get to that is either have a URL or just put in Google Alerts from Google and it'll pop it up. You do have to have a Google account, but once you do, and you can put in some keywords like what Gary's done here is search for me, search on the web for the name Gary Pierce.
Yeah, that came up by default for me when I just put this in at your suggestion. So it's google.com/alerts.
And make sure that you're logged in with the Google account. And then in the create alert, so you might want to put in amateur radio now into that box, Gary.
Okay. Ham Radio Now. That's the name of the show.
Ham Radio Now. There you go.
Create an alert.
Mm-hmm.
That's the Gmail address that I use for my general correspondence. You guys, K KN4AQ at ARVN TVs. What I recommend, yeah, but I got
the one you might want to set up. But yeah. What I would do is set up a bunch of these, and then you get alerted when anything happens on the internet with that name or with that. You can put things in quotes. You can do something and something, so you can make it as interesting as you want, and get alerted when there's a news item or a anything that comes out in one of the major newspapers. So it's pretty cool. I've got a bunch of links for my call sign and for my name, although I'm not the only Rich Casey in the world anymore. In the early days of the internet, I was the only one. If you put my name into Google, you got me. You don't anymore. I gave up trying to be number one. But you are the only KN4AQ.
That's one of the cool things about ham radio call signs, is that they are pretty darn unique. There are, every once in a while, if I'm doing a web search on somebody's call sign, some foreign language stuff comes up where that combination of numbers and letters has showed up. But for the most part, it's very unique. In my early days on the internet and with computers, most of it was ham radio oriented. It was, you know, very hobbyish, and I made up everything based on KN4AQ. Well, once I started using it for business, that was kind of a problem. I had to go eliminate some of that, or at least push it to the background as best I could, and put in some more professional stuff. But by the time I got on anything, Gary Pierce was not available. But as an email address, KN4AQ was available. Although Google, Gmail, Google, you can't put in a 5-character Gmail name. KN4AQ is not acceptable as a Gmail address.
I never did know that.
Well, you don't have N5CSU at gmail.com.
That's correct.
Yeah.
I live at AWRL.net. Yeah, when Google first opened, I waited in line and got Rich Casey. So I've kind of made it my mission to try and grab my name on every service as it comes up. And there's a really good bass musician in Rhode Island named Rich Casey, and he and I kind of duke it out. Some of them I let them win if they're music-related sites. But so that's really all I wanted to say about Google. The other tool that I use all the time is something called Evernote. And it's a free service. You're looking at the intro to it.
The idea
of Evernote is you can store anything from any device to Evernote. Think of it as a notebook in the cloud. You get a bunch of it for free, a bunch of space, but you can set up an account. You can set it up on your iPad, on your Android, on your home computer. You can share it with other folks. They now have a business system that looks quite good. But this is a great place to clip and save anything, including like the list that I sent to you, Gary, of these websites was an Evernote checklist, which I shared with you via email. So it works very, very well. I've never had a fail.
I'm going to show you. There it is. There is my current Evernote. And as you can see, it's a mess. Yeah, I've been using Evernote for a while. I've got all these notebooks. I've got all of these notes. And maybe you can help me figure out how to organize Evernote better.
Mine is the same way, unfortunately.
Yeah, I like it a lot. I started using it as a free service. And what I discovered is that you can't save things locally on the free service. I'm not sure what they offer these days, but I wanted to save things and use them without an internet connection, because not every place you go has got one. On my phone, pretty much always have it, but on my tablet, it's Wi-Fi only, so wasn't always available. And I wanted to be able to save stuff locally, and I don't think you could with the free service. So I bought their service, and it's pretty good. Worth the money. It's $45 a year or something. So.
Yeah, it's well worthwhile, I think, and I'm really glad they've stayed independent. They've been very classy. I've never seen it go down. That's one that I do pay for. I think it's worth supporting the effort. Really cool service. The other one that I live on is a thing called Dropbox. And Dropbox is one of the very first cloud services. And, of course, Amazon has it now, and Apple has one, too, and so does Google. Dropbox, I like it because it's agnostic. It works on my Android. It works on my PC. It works on my iPhone, on my iPad. I actually have share several huge directories with my Property Owners Association that I'm president of, and I also have one for all my radio club stuff and also for the Humane Society stuff. So the cool thing is it becomes just like another hard drive on your PC, but you can also access this stuff from any other device that's on the internet. They do have two-factor authentication on this. I highly encourage you to turn that on. I found out recently when I turned it on, I was afraid I was going to lose those connections that I have that I've shared directories with, like the POA. It turns out that the two-factor authentication works at my end. Unless they've enabled it, they can still access those files. So I found Dropbox to be extremely great. One of the applications I use it for is all the manuals for all my radios, handy talkies, computer stuff, everything goes in there. Typically, you know, you can get an online version by Googling and finding it. And I take a PDF and put it in Dropbox. So I have a folder called manuals. And within manuals, I have radio, which is about 80% of the manuals, and non-radio, which is every other manual I need. It's really handy to have. It does not cost anything. I think you get 4 gigs for free. If you recommend other people, you get more space. Hey, that'd be cool. If any of you guys want to send me an email with your email address, I will you can say that I've recommended you, and I'll get more space. But Dropbox is one of those things that I can't live without. It's really a terrific service.
Have you tried any of the other systems service? Google offers free space. Microsoft offers free space.
Yes. The problem that I have is that I started saying, well, I'll put the POA stuff in Google, and I can't remember where it is. So all of these work pretty well. I've found that the Microsoft one, which comes free with Office 365, which I now pay $100 a year to have the latest version of Office on all of my computers, including the iPad. I think that's well worth it. I think you get a gigabyte on the cloud service that Microsoft offers. I think it's slower, and I really prefer Dropbox because all my stuff's there. I keep the directories extremely clean. iCloud, the Apple service, I thought was kind of a joke for a long time. They've gotten better at it. The main thing I do with iCloud is I pay them $25 a year, and they manage my 28 gigs of music in the cloud for me, including stuff that I bought and including some of my high school rock band tapes that I ripped and put onto my iPod 10 years ago. They actually are in the cloud, and when I bought a new used computer recently, I was able to pull all that stuff down. So I think my $25 a year with Apple is worth it just for that. You do have to decide where you're going to store your stuff. Otherwise, you end up looking in 3 or 4 of these services for your information. That's why I'm kind of stuck with Dropbox. I'm real happy with it.
Yeah, I have done the Google thing. This is my Google Drive. And I haven't made extensive use of it. There's more pictures and stuff in it than anything useful. But my goal is to make things a little bit better. I've got a few folders in it, but I haven't really used it extensively. And I think, what is it? I've used 327 megabytes, and that's 2%. So I've got a ways to go. But a lot of good services. Dropbox is a good one.
Yeah. It's still a good idea to have a local hard drive that you back everything up to and then disconnect it. Don't leave it on your computer. So if it gets hacked, at least you can get back to where you are. But for everyday use, I really rely on Dropbox. The integration with the iPad is really nice. And now that Office 365, Microsoft finally realized that there is such a thing as an iPad, and they support Word and Excel and PowerPoint really well on the iPad. And I can open it in Dropbox, start a document on my PC, and finish it on an iPad. And and you'd never know the difference. It's really quite cool. So in my top five, the other one that I want to talk about is Feedly. This goes back to the early days of the internet and RSS, which is called a real simple syndication. Feeds are sometimes a little bit hard to understand, but once you break through the breakthrough, you really will appreciate it. I follow about 120 websites on a pretty regular basis, and virtually all of them support RSS. And so you set up an account on Feedly. Again, that's free, and you add in the websites that you care about, their news feed, their RSS feed for that website. You put it into Feedly, and then you can set up folders. I have folders for politics, for Dallas, for ham radio, for weather, for emergency management, and so forth and so forth, tech. And then within tech, I have a bunch in public relations and communications and so forth. And then what you can do is open Feedly from, again, any device and see the news stories from each one of these sites. You can just say, show me my inbox, which will show you kind of a representation of what's new since the last time you looked at Feedly. This allows you to pretty quickly look through 120 websites and see what's up. So, you know, if you follow 20 different newspapers, you're going to get some duplication in the headlines because of the national headlines. But typically on a newspaper like the Dallas Morning News has about 50 different feeds. So you can sign up for local news, Fort Worth news only, politics and so forth. Add those feeds to Feedly and then hop through your headlines when you see an interesting story. Typically you'll get a thumbnail, a couple of sentences, or maybe the first paragraph. In some cases you'll see the whole article. You can click on that and go to the main story in the web. Then hit your back key, go back to Feedly and move on. So I do that a couple times a day on the iPad. I do it on the Android sometimes before I switch over to Kindle when I go to bed. So you can kind of keep up on your world on the internet just using Feedly. It's a terrific service. And most websites, including like WordPress websites, you'll see something either it'll say feeds at the bottom. There'll be a little RSS icon. With WordPress, it'll actually say subscribe, and it'll pop up your Feedly lead, and you can put it in there. If not, you can set up an account on Feedly, and over on the right, it'll say discover, and then they've got a whole bunch categories set up. You can set up and say, yeah, I want to add technology, I want to add this, I want to add that, see how it works, and then personalize it over time. But there's no way in heck that I would be able to keep up with all the websites and all the activities I want to by going from website to website. So using Feedly is a great way to do it. I used to use Hootsuite when I worked at Raytheon to manage our Facebook feeds and to watch a whole bunch of different websites. But since I've retired, I don't have to do that as intensively. I've found that Feedly really does the job for me. So highly recommend it. It's in my definite Casey's top five is Feedly.
Okay, then that's one that I haven't used and I could benefit from because I still kind of scramble to get around from one place to another, and which means I miss stuff or I waste time. And
right.
There's not enough right. time to waste anymore.
Well, you know, the interesting thing is for the ham radio one, we'll talk about some websites here that are called aggregators, and what they do is kind of scrounge the net for interesting stories, either because of the ham radio in the title, or in the story, somewhere in the article. And what I found is I can hit those sites in Feedly, and I'll see interesting articles from blogs or websites that I didn't even know existed. And so I might, if the website looks interesting, I'll add the website itself to Feedly, kind of bump it up once, and then, you can check that website whenever it updates. The cool thing is when you go into a folder, like say CNET, CNET is a good Feedly feed to go to. And, you can sign up for PC or laptop. And once you look at them and say, yeah, I've seen all those, you just say read them all. And then that won't show up in your Feedly until it updates. So that makes it really cool to keep up on things. it used to be, I used to use Google Reader for this. It was a terrific service. For some reason, Google decided to discontinue it. Feedly, they was a few guys that said, let's see if we can pick this up. And I do pay, I pay a service fee for that, but it's, I believe it's free. I know it is for most users. I think I kicked in just to get the concept going and make it a reality. And it's really highly recommended. So let's see, enough about Feedly. The next thing I want to talk about is a very interesting concept. You know, the Internet of Things is coming, in addition to having Internet thermostats like Nest, and now we have Internet light bulbs from different companies, including they started about $100 right now. The Internet of Things is coming, and of course, the cloud computing is already here. So a website started up a couple years ago called If This, Then That. And on the internet, it's ifttt.com. And the way to look at this is it's kind of a web application automation. And if you think of what you would like the computer to do, for me, I want the computer to do repetitive things that I can tell them what to do and then sit back and let it happen, kind of like what Feedly does with news. Well, if this, then that takes it to the next step. So it says, if the temperature drops to 32 degrees, turn this web-enabled heater on. And as there's more and more devices that are web-enabled, this makes it much easier. So there's now, 142 companies are now working on working with If This, Then That. So you can say, for instance, there it is, if any new photo by my with my name, then put it in my Facebook. If there is a change in a stock market price, put it in this Excel spreadsheet. And the cool thing is, this is free. It's absolutely free. I haven't seen any ham radio applications yet. I hope someone will take the ball and run with it. But If This, Then That is definitely a website to sign up for. Look at the recipes, they call it, that are already set up. There's thousands of them. You can look at the most used, and I'm sure you'll find a use for it. I've been using it for a couple of years. I use an RSS feed in the IF, and at 7 p.m., I get the weather forecast texted to me for the next day. So if there's a change in this RSS feed, then do this. So it's a very, very cool concept. And I think it's going to grow like crazy. Again, this is an independent company. The service is free. I'm not sure how they're going to make their money, but I'm sure these brands, as they join and add recipes, are probably kicking some money in the bucket to keep them going. But highly recommended. Spend an hour on that, and you may just find, look through the recipes that have already been done. And that's a recipe is an if this, then that, that's already been set up. And you can say, yeah, just add that to my channel. I have about 10 of them that are set up all the time. One of them that I just set up, we'll see how if I want to leave it on or off. You can go into your account and turn on or off the recipe in a minute. I set one up last night. I noticed somebody put up it's if a movie has been added to Netflix Instant, send me an email. So we're going to see how many of those work. But it doesn't have to go to email. You can set up an Excel spreadsheet, and you can have it go into an Excel spreadsheet and then just check the spreadsheet when you want. So really interesting idea.
Doing that, the Netflix thing requires Netflix to be one of the companies that's connected with them?
Yeah. And apparently it already is.
Okay.
Or an RSS feed. And Netflix has a bunch of RSS feeds available. Again, it is a good use of time to learn a little bit about how RSS works. It's not going to take you more than a couple hours. And you'll find that almost every website has RSS feed available. Once you have that, then you can say if a condition in this feed happens, then do what I want something to do. So very, very cool.
Yeah, I've used RSS for some very simple things, and it's going to be part of Ham Radio Now a bit more, but I've only learned a tiny little bit about it, and clearly it is something that's far more powerful than I'm aware of.
Yeah, and it actually started back in the point cast days of early internet. That's when the RSS was invented. And we set up point cast at work years and years ago. And what you want computers to do, I mean, my thing with computers is do the repetitive stuff for me. Don't make me do the hard stuff of setting it up and then let the computer do the repetitive checking. And that's what RSS does for you. So let's see, real quickly, everybody knows about YouTube, I think. If you're watching this video, you obviously do. There's a real interesting program called Vine, which was set up specifically for the, originally for the iPhone, but I believe it's available now on the PC and on Android. It allows you to do, I think it's 5 or 6 seconds of video. And you wouldn't think you could do much in 5 or 6 seconds of video, but I have just been amazed at what you do in 6 seconds. You said, and you have to spend some time and get something to loop. But it's really funny. And the kids, especially the teenagers, have had a lot of fun with it.
Do you have some vines out there? Should I search for you somewhere?
No.
Okay. You're only watching.
I'm strictly a user. And I haven't done any video editing in a long, long time. Though that's on my list of to-dos, is to learn how to video edit again, Gary, with the
There's tool. Something I know how to do you don't. Wow.
There you go.
Oh, that must be me skiing. No, it's gone.
There's some amazing stuff in there, and some of it probably not for kids. But anyway, next one, Wikipedia. Of course, everybody knows about Wikipedia. It's pretty much where I go to find out what's up on just about anything. What I would suggest, though, if you guys that are active users, set yourself up an account. Over in the upper right, there's a thing called login. You know, everyone is an expert on something. And if you set up your own account, you can go in there and help Wikipedia be more accurate in the area that you're in. So I've added some things to the little town of Gunbarrel City in Texas, where we have our lake house, and I've added some things about ham radio. I added WLUC AM to the Loyola entry in Wikipedia. And I was involved with the CALS initiative with the DOD back in the 80s, and I've gone in there and added some things. The interesting thing is you can go in, you can see the changes. If you look behind the curtain at one of these entries in Wikipedia, you can see what changes have been made, who made them. And then you can write a little bit about yourself in your account with Wikipedia. The other thing is you can also set up, but please send me notification if anyone changes it. And so that's especially needed with some of the political politicians and politics in Wikipedia that sometimes changes within an hour. Apparently, some of the Super Bowl stuff changed during the game, from what I heard.
So notice that there's no Ham Radio Now entry. I'm not sure what this ask for it to be created. I believe I can't create it myself, but you could. Apparently.
Maybe.
Yeah. A little more detailed than we want. I have actually modified a Wikipedia page, modified one on D-Star at one point.
Oh, yeah.
That's as deep as I got into it. And my stuff was still there for a while anyway.
I think the cool thing with Wikipedia is it really is user-generated. It started as user-generated content. And to be a good citizen of the internet, add your expertise. You know, that's what the cool thing, to be part of it.
Yeah. They're also, it didn't come up this time because I guess their fund drive is over, but they're user-supported. So send them some money. Right. Send them some money, then send me some money. You know, at the beginning of this program, I forgot to make the pitch. I'll make the pitch real quickly here. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. This guy back there, that's Arvin. He's our chief financial officer. Stop by hamradionow.tv if you enjoy the programs. And you can help keep us going. And that's the end of the commercial announcement. And now, back to our regularly scheduled program.
I wanted to mention one that isn't on our list, Gary, but I found I used it twice yesterday. And that's called lifehacker.com, lifehacker.com. And it's always very interesting to check that. Of course, it's in my Feedly. There's a lot of updates every day, but it's tips and downloads for things on life. Some of it is very computer-generated or computer-related, but some of it has to do to how to reorganize your sock drawer. It's just very, very interesting from kind of a tech perspective way of looking at life. So Life Hackers is a fun website. And that's one of them I've been meaning to see if I can submit an article to. There's one on instant meals. Pretty cool. And before we leave things in general, I do want to do a shameless promotion for richcasey.net, which is my blog that I've had for years and years. It's called Casey's Place. It started on StarText in 1982, back before there was an internet, and it's kind of moved to several different platforms. But I don't update it all the time, but I would like you to, here's what I'd like you to do. Set up your Feedly, and if you scroll down to the bottom, Gary, I think you will see a follow me. Oh, yeah, there it is. It's a little black spot at the bottom of the screen in front of my picture, I think, that says follow me. And if you click on that, you can add me to your Feedly so that when I do update my website, you get it in your feed. That makes sense? There you go.
Okay, so
Or you can get an email, either way.
Okay. All this stuff is so complicated. So,
yep. If I don't update it regularly, I keep saying when I retire, that was something I was going to update all the time, but life interferes. But I'm going to update it pretty regularly. And the main thing is, Gary, at the top, scroll all the way up. On the right, you'll see my latest tweets. But there's a tab there that says About Me. You can skip that, but Intro to Ham Radio, Get on the Air. I've had people that I've met over the years ask me, go up a little bit, and you'll see a black bar. There you go. And I've been setting up a page, which is real easy to do in WordPress, with overviews of ham radio, but also how to get your license. With folks wanting to get their ham license, there's links to a bunch of different ways to get your license, different references online and books and so forth. Scroll down just a little bit, Gary. Yeah, studying for the test or upgrade. And the last couple of weeks I've been updating this after scrounging around on the internet, and then once you get your license and so forth. But anyway, I thought I'd pass that along.
That's a big bite to take. Introduction to ham radio. I've seen so many people try to do this, and they point the fire hose at someone and try to do everything all at once. It's not easy.
Yeah, actually, the best one I've seen, I think, is that first link, which was written for, I think, Business Insider Australia. It was a ham that wrote about getting involved with ham radio. I thought it was a really good intro. Speaking of fire hose, if we kind of move into social media, Twitter and Facebook.
I thought I had this page up, but I didn't. So there's the one you were talking about. I got to go look and see what I've got punched up on the air a little bit more often. Okay, so Twitter and ham radio?
Yeah, let's talk about Twitter for a minute. I got on Twitter, I was one of the first million or so anyway. They started at South by Southwest down in Austin, which is another thing that I should go to every year. But Twitter really is a worldwide party line, and it is definitely a fire hose thing. So it's something that you really have to tweak a little bit, or you won't get a whole lot of use out of it. It can be somewhat overwhelming. But the easiest way to look at Twitter is as a party line. What you can do is put in your friends, but you can also put in Ham Radio Now. You get an update when he updates. The other thing that I like to do is do a search. And that really, if you, in the search box, if you put a hashtag HamR, what you'll see is here's the results of the latest search of ham radio, what's going on in ham radio. So you can see that first guy, KP4 Radio, he updated 3 minutes ago with an item, QRZ forums, repeater banning with reflectors, talk groups, and then a link. And you can see that 19 minutes ago, DX Zone Ham Radio updated. So this is a great way to see what's going on with ham radio and Twitter. But you can do a search in the upper right on anything.
So this search worked because everybody who put a tweet out included this in the tweet.
Yeah. Hashtag.
And, and then the search up here looked for that in the tweet.
Yeah.
So every tweet that shows up will have it. And I see most of them just have that, but some actually say all the way through Ham Radio.
Yes.
And doing that, it costs you dearly in your 144 characters.
Right, right. Which is why HamR was the first one that that popped out, and folks have used Ham Radio. You can use as many as you want, but remember, you only have so many characters. So, you know, I suggest what you do is look through there, and when you find somebody that looks kind of interesting, click on their account and look at their tweets, and then if you like what they're doing, then just add them to your list, your follow list. Then when you go into Twitter on your homepage, you'll get the stuff that you're following. So, you know, I follow about 700 or 800 folks and companies, and there's about 700 or 800 people that follow me. I'm Rich Casey. I was got on Twitter real early and grabbed my name. So if you want to follow me, just put in you can put in Rich Casey and you should see me pop up. Yep, there you go. And then you just click on, you can add me. I think you have to click on my name to add me within my account right there. And follow. There you go.
How come I haven't been following you?
I don't know. I've got 2,900 tweets, 1,300, I'm following 1,300, and 811 follow me. So the cool thing here is that you can follow folks that you care about. What I do actually is I publish most of my stuff, like that latest thing on net neutrality, which I'm a big believer in. I publish this here on Twitter, and then I have, I believe if I'm using if this then that, to also push it to LinkedIn and push it to Facebook. So I only have to publish things once. And we'll talk about why you'd want to do that a little bit later, but you'll see this is the stuff that I've been publishing in the last couple weeks. KC5FM is somebody that I follow, and I think he's thanking me for a retweet. If you see something you like, you can hit the little retweet icon there, which is the there you go, and that retweets whatever's out there to your followers.
Twitter has been criticized for kind of no filter. It's a bullying zone.
Yes, absolutely.
Doesn't have to be. Doesn't have to be for you either, but the kids, you know, seem to have that problem.
Yeah, and that's why you have to learn what a hashtag is. And I remember when they first started using hashtags, I thought, why didn't I think of that? Because really, it's a very simple concept. You put in something that normally wouldn't be used in conversation, and hashtag HamR typically wouldn't come out as a word, so it's not going to pop out there. And you can have a hashtag for anything, and that's why you see folks say hashtag grimace or hashtag smile or whatever, and you do the grouping on the fly, kind of user-generated grouping. And, of course, that's what the Internet's all about, is user-generated content. So that's where Twitter excels. When there's a news item, I believe now Twitter has an icon for breaking news or trending or something like that. If a news story pops out, that's where I'll typically go to Twitter, click on breaking, and see what's up. Usually within 2 or 3 minutes of a major news story, you'll start seeing stuff on Twitter. Doesn't necessarily mean it's true, but it does mean that enough people are seeing it and retweeting it.
Yeah, you have to be your own filter in a case like that.
Absolutely.
The hashtag thing, that's getting used on a few other services now, and some people are actually using it in just face-to-face speech. you know, they're too deep into that if they do that.
Totally. Yeah.
We used to call it a pound sign, right?
Right.
So a crosshatch.
Well, it's part of the pound. Yeah. We'd say pound HamR, but the hashtag has stuck. So Twitter is cool because you can sit there and it'll just update all day long. You can kind of get sucked in watching the blinking lights, if you will. But when there's a news story, Twitter's the place to go. Don't go to Facebook. Either go to CNN or go to Twitter, and you'll find out what's going on pretty quickly. Someone will link to a local story and local news source, and you can follow it from there. But Twitter, my Twitter feed updates, you know, every second or two, if you let it. If once you build up folks, columnists. I follow a lot of the national reporters, their personal Twitter accounts. If their company will let them tweet, some of them won't. But it's very interesting news source.
Yep, Ham Radio Now is here on Twitter. Just use it pretty much to let people know when a new program has been put out. But if I were sitting here at my main page and I wanted to just get an idea of what the heck is going on out there in the world, what would I do?
Go to your home.
Okay, that's what I'm sitting on, apparently.
Okay. And then scroll down a little bit. And okay.
Well, this is what the people I'm following are sending.
Yes. And then on the left, yeah, still a lot of Brian Williams stuff. See on the left with the trends? That's what's going on right now. So the trend out of the blue, Pepsi's paying to promote that. That's how Twitter's trying to break even.
Okay. So the Dean Smith is a local basketball coach who has passed away today.
Okay. Brian Williams is still up there with Brian Gate, Tar Heel, Carolina. So this is looks like it may very well be based on your account.
Yeah, it must be kind of localized.
Because I wouldn't recognize that stuff. And, of course, I'd check my iPad, but I'm talking to you on it. I feel very weird not having a computer in front of me.
Okay, but let's see. So if I'd say I knew that something was going on with a guy named Brian Williams, but I wasn't looking for the trending, oops, I could just type it in like this.
Right.
If I knew how to type.
Yep.
And then a bunch of tweets are going to come up all about what's going on with him.
Yep. Now, the at sign is their account. So if you do a search on at Brian Williams, one word, you'll probably pull up his account.
Ooh, maybe he'll tell us what's really going on. He's probably disappeared.
He's probably... some folks will use at Brian Williams in their tweet, and of course that won't show up. So you're not... Okay, now there's... Let's see if he's gone into radio silence.
Seeing blank. I'm not sure what I'm supposed to see.
Looks like he hasn't tweeted.
Yeah, well, yeah, I'm sure he's in silence, so I guess, you know, there's nothing there. All right, so, you know, we could spend probably an hour show on every one of these things trying to get all the details of how to use them. What's next?
Let's move on to Facebook real quickly. First thing about Facebook is they change their security settings all the time. And the idea with Facebook is they want to know as much about you so they can market properly to you. And that's okay, I guess, but you need to go in as a user and check your security settings. They have made it a lot easier to see what other people see of you for your friends and at the friends level and at the public level. So make sure you do that. But Facebook also, as opposed to Twitter shows you the latest stuff that you've either signed up for or in general what's going on. Facebook tries to say, here are the things that we think that you need to see. Some of them are paid for. Some of them are people that you've signed up to follow, but for some reason, Facebook decides you don't need to see them. For instance, I never see my wife's posts, even though I have her set up as my wife. But I do see more posts from some financial service that I don't care about, and I can't turn it off. So Facebook is aggravating. It's, of course, omnipresent. There's nothing you can do about it except use it to the way that you want to use it. There's another service called LinkedIn that is more business-related. What I would say, my recommendation, and I can't do this anymore, but for those of you that are not heavily involved in any of these, use Facebook, follow your friends in Facebook, and follow your work companions and the folks that you work with at other companies. Use LinkedIn more for your business connections and Facebook more for your family and friends. When I got on Facebook like 3 days after, maybe the first day that they allowed people besides college students, you used to have to have a .edu email prefix before you could get on. But as soon as they opened the domains to other domains, I got on pretty quickly. So I have a business stuff and personal stuff and family stuff and everything. Everybody's on Facebook with me, and I'm real clear on that I can't really undo that, and I'm not even going to try.
You're a fiend for getting on all this stuff as soon as it hits the streets.
Yeah.
Apparently.
Yeah, I mean, that's been something I've always been interested in. It was also part of my job at Raytheon for a long time, was to keep up on social media and help the company kind of decide what communication vehicle they wanted to use. Yeah. I'm not
on LinkedIn. I get about four email requests a day from people to follow them on LinkedIn. Evidently, it's all automated. I'm sure they're not specifically picking me to send.
Well, they're actually trying to connect with you for business reasons, probably. And I've got 500 or 600 connections in LinkedIn. It's a lot of folks that I used to work with, but also vendors. And you can also connect up with companies in LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a really great place to post your resume, an online version of your resume if you're looking for another job, but also if you're looking for connections in your industry. I used to think whenever I got a profile or a link request in LinkedIn, it was somebody looking for a job. That's not really true. I think if you're in business, you should be on LinkedIn, unless you're an island and you don't need business connections. What I've found actually is there are some really great networking networks within LinkedIn, including a very active amateur radio network that's within LinkedIn. So I would encourage everyone to use LinkedIn especially if you're in the business world or in college and want to get in a job after. But also take a look at the different networks that are available inside of LinkedIn, and I think you'll find some very interesting stuff. Very long discussion that went on for about a month about ARIES and the changes in emergency management requirements and so forth, that I was interested to see that it was all happening inside of LinkedIn.
Really?
You can't get to LinkedIn unless you set up a free account. They have a cost for a professional account. I haven't seen any need to ever do that. But yeah, so LinkedIn, I thought they would kind of disappear, but they've done very, very well in the business world, and just like Facebook has done in the commercial world. And there is some crossover, but they are really two different tools for different uses.
Okay. I've certainly heard about them for a long time. Again, people have been bugging me to connect with them, but I've never done it. So it sounds like even though I'm, you know, my business career is winding down, it's still got a ways to go. So I guess I probably should.
Let's see. Let's talk about Reddit for just a second. REDDIT. This is one of your wilder things that's happening. And I have this go through my Feedly, so I don't have to wander around in here, but there's a lot of very weird stuff on the internet and, controversial rising new top. You'll see even across the top there. But if you do a search for amateur radio on the upper right, you'll actually see that there's amateur radio. They call it a subreddit. It's a topic within Reddit. This is where a lot of the cat stuff comes from, the cat pictures. They start out there. And see that first one, /r/amateur radio. That /r means a subreddit. It's a subtopic within. And you'll see some Q&A. That 43 means there's 43 responses. Very interesting stuff, and you don't have to have an account. You don't. You can do this as a read only. I would suggest you do this at home because some of this language in here. This is pretty wild stuff.
Not safe for work.
Most of it in amateur radio, it's fine, I'm sure. But if you start wandering around, you might see some very very interesting stuff. But I ran into Reddit because I was wandering around in Feedly, and I did an amateur radio link inside of Feedly, and this popped up and found a very interesting article by a gal that's on the cover of one of the ARRL publications. She'd gotten her license, and I think a college gal, and wrote about her experience in ham radio on here, and had about 50, 60 responses, including "What's ham radio? I never heard of it," you know, that kind of thing. So this is going to skew younger. And there's nothing wrong with that. You're only as young as your keyboard, I guess. There's a bunch of other ones like Pinterest. I've got a Pinterest account. My wife uses Pinterest an awful lot for looking for projects for the house and all that. It's more photo-based, image-based. I haven't really saw a big need for it, but I...
I've lost Pinterest in my huge... Oh, there we go.
Yeah, you pin a... You can continue. Of course, Facebook, you can use that as your account. Yep. And, of course, Facebook knows everything you do in Pinterest. So wherever possible, I set up a separate account for each thing with a unique password. And that way, at least I can try and keep my identity somewhat safe. But let's zoom in a little bit on ham radio. Of course, everyone knows about ARL.org or .net. It's a terrific website. It has RSS feed, so you can add it to Feedly and see when the ARRL has updated their news. That's my number one go-to ham radio site. But there's a bunch of other ones I use an awful lot. One is QRZ.com, QRZ.com. And the main thing here is update your profile. Put in your call sign. If you've updated yours, Gary, I think you have.
So we'll search over here, KN4AQ, and we'll see my profile with a picture that's about 10 years old.
There's
a lot more hair up there.
Yeah.
And I try to keep it updated. Every once in a while I go back and say, whoa, I haven't put anything in there in 2 years, but I try.
So everyone that's a ham has an account for free. And I would really suggest that every ham go in there and update with a picture and put what you're doing, what your background is, put frequencies, anything you want. It's a free service. And I've found, especially when I'm working folks in other countries, that they'll pull up QRZ and say, oh yeah, that's what it looks like. You know, that's what you look like. Or, hey, I see that you're an AMSAT or something like that. There's my Dallas house. And you can scroll down. I think you'll see the lake. Yep. So, you know, this area is free. Again, this is a user-generated content site. It's also, they ask for an occasional contribution. It's really a great idea to do that. Here's amateur radio news.
That's the part that I look at the most. I mean, I use the lookup to find out about people, but it's this news part that I spend the most time looking in. And all the Ham Radio Now episodes get announced there when one comes out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great service, and you know, it'd be good to send the owner of that a few bucks every year to keep it supported, because it really is a terrific service. You do have to. You can look at a lot of the stuff without logging in. Once you log in, you can see the address of a user of another ham. You can also see their a lat long and so forth, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, I'll log out and then bring you back up. And it's going to be a limited amount of wants me to log in again. Limited amount of stuff that it will tell me about you. Well, I'm getting the biography. I thought I wasn't even going to see that, but I can't see your email. I guess maybe the email is the only thing I can't see if I don't log in.
No, all right.
It wants to log in for more detail. So
They've
added this logbook thing and QSLs and stuff like that. I'm not sure what all that gets you.
I believe they're setting that up with Logbook of the World.
Yeah.
Which is something that's on my list of things to do that I haven't gotten to yet.
Yeah, I need to. This is not a good background picture to put in the middle there. I need to learn more about what they're doing with their logbook and QSLs and all that stuff. Because right now, I'm sure none of that stuff counts for awards from ARL and CQ and stuff.
Right.
So
yeah.
I'll go give Fred is the guy that runs the thing. I've sat in his camper. It's a nicer trailer than most of the houses I've lived in my life, except for the one I'm in right now, because Cindy bought this. But he's a very nice guy, and I'll probably see him down at Orlando. So, by the way, I'm going to Orlando, I'm pretty sure, next week.
Cool.
So maybe I'll see some of you. Going to go to Orlando this year?
Have you
ever been?
No, I never have been.
Get on the road. It's a couple of days' drive from Dallas, but very nice.
Not a bad drive. Let me talk about Echolink for just a second. If you're a ham, you need to get on Echolink. It's really cool ham radio internet connection. You can do it from the radio. You can do it from your PC. You can do it from your phone or from your tablet. It's really a cool service. You can connect to other folks that are on Echolink that are either on the radio or on the computer. There's conference bridges. There's links. I have a link running here at my house that's on a simplex 2 meter frequency. And so folks connect in to me and I'll have my handy talkie in the other room and be able to talk to them. So it's really a really cool free service. If you're a ham, you should really get on Echolink. It's really, really very cool.
You may find a local repeater is already part of it.
Yes. Yeah. So Dallas Amateur Radio Club here has Echolink and people drop in from all over the world. Our Cedar Creek repeater has, and it's a lot of fun. You can, with Echolink, you can also connect, to conference bridges like World, Do Drop In is a big one. There's quite a few folks in there that have roundtable QSOs that people drop in and out of. So really a fun ham radio to internet application. The next one that I really enjoy is a thing called dxheat.com, dxheat.com. If you just click on DX Cluster there, this is, again, a free service, and it is very cool. What's going on here is you're seeing the latest DX cluster connections, and it updates continuously, and you can filter by band, you can filter by mode, or you can turn them all on. So you can, you post directly to this, and so you can see that the W3LPL just talked to 7Q7BP, wherever that is, and on 20 meters. So you can also see, looks like 10 meters is open now. There's W3ZJ talk to P32 on sideband. So that tells you that, and JW9JKA is calling CQ and K9PG just worked them. But if you scroll down, you'll see the solar activity. And then I really like this band activity. This shows you what's hot. So that second, that first column is Europe. In Europe, 40 and 80 are screaming. In North America, 10 meters is open.
So it's nighttime in Europe, which is why those low frequencies are open.
There you go.
As we speak, you know, I don't know when people are watching this, but as we speak, it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon Eastern time, so evening, early evening in Europe.
So this is based on the number of posts to the cluster. So you can
there's nobody on 12 meters. What's going on?
Yeah. That tells you 12 meters is open, though.
Yeah.
10 meters is open. So I think this is really cool. It's only been around for a few months, at least that I knew about. It's a free service, and I think it's really very neat.
I guess what I'm surprised is on this first page that I'm looking at, I haven't seen K1N listed anywhere.
Oh, there it is. K1N, yeah.
I'm looking in the wrong column.
I look in the DX. The poster is on the left. So, okay, DL.
Okay, yeah, so there we go.
So Germany just worked him on 14155.
Yeah. I should have him in the background here.
Germany, Bravo, Kilo, Germany, 5-9.
I'm listening on that.
Bravo, Kilo, Germany, 5-9.
And we're not hearing the station he's working because they're working split, so.
Okay.
They're working split, but you're hearing a guy call them on their frequency, which is what everybody's been yelling about.
Yeah, I'm not hearing that on my audio for some reason.
Oh, I guess I'm not sending it to you. Let's see. Does that send it to you?
Yep.
Okay.
There we go.
Learning how to run my mixer.
Okay, so that Ninja Zulu 4, Bravo, Quebec, Victoria, 5-9.
Okay, so cool. I haven't worked them either.
Oh, okay. I'll duke it out with you after this broadcast.
Yeah.
Another one that's interesting for propagation that I just found out about a few days ago is WSPRnet.org. It's not on the list I gave you, Gary, but it's WSPRnet.org. wringing.org, and then click on map over on the right. And this
shows
you the propagation using WSPR, which is a very low power digital mode that W1JT developed. It uses 1, 2, or 5 watts, but that shows you what's going on propagation wise on probably at 10 megahertz. You'd have to zoom in to see. Or move down below the map, and it'll tell you. But I think the default is a 10 megahertz.
Nothing's happening in South America. Okay, let me go down here and see. Okay, yeah.
30 meters.
So let's look at 20. Is there any whisper going on 20? I guess we'll find out.
Click on. I think you got to click on update, Gary. Right there.
There we go. Okay, well, clearly there's a lot going on 20. There's still only one station in South America who's using this. But things are clearly hopping to Europe, and I don't see any paths to Asia right now. And one station in Greenland is on.
Remember, this is just looking at Whisper, as you say. That's how the acronym is set.
Is Whisper an automated thing, or is it purely manual?
I think it's automated.
Okay, because that's why so many stations are on there.
Yeah, that's nice. I think you're supposed to be a control op for it, so you're not supposed to run it 24 hours unless you live next to the radio, at least in the U.S.
Okay, but that'll give you an instant idea of what's open to where. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, yeah. Let's see, running down my list, the next one I have is ZDXZone. .com. This is one of these directories that's kind of interesting. I use this through Feedly. I let Feedly send me some of these links. By the way, over on the right here, you see that orange 67. That's RSS feed right there. So that's what you would you'd put that link into Feedly. That's the universal sign for RSS. But if you scroll down a little bit in this on this page, you'll see. See, this is just an aggregator, so it's looking if you click on, you know, Aries, Races, something, any of those, you'll pull up another list, and it'll do lists within lists within lists. So, of course, it's trying to get you so it can sell you ads over on the right-hand side. That's its whole world, but most popular, you click on one of those, and then eventually you get to a website. But if you wander around in here, you will actually find some very interesting stuff that you didn't know existed on the Internet. So that's where an aggregator kind of helps promote these individual websites and also helps promote themselves.
Now, would Ham Radio Now be in here anywhere?
Probably would, because this is all automated.
But CB Radio's there. We better be there. I'm not sure what you would look at.
I'm not either.
Hams don't understand this concept of ham radio broadcasting yet, so
they
don't know where to put us.
Been around since 1996. I didn't realize that.
Wow. They're old.
Yep. I ran into that through Feedly because this has links to everywhere known to man. So next one up is Yahoo Groups. What I wanted to say about Yahoo Groups is
that... Yeah, and I discovered video.
Oh, there you go.
But...
Huh.
I don't know. Don't know what this is. It doesn't appear to be YouTube, but it might be.
Yeah, those look like YouTube videos.
Let's see. Yeah, just a YouTube video. So they haven't found me. Okay,
the main thing here is when you're in DX Zone, you need to click on the link at the top. Otherwise, you're in an ad. I think they kind of, you'll click one of those so you give them an ad. But.
Okay, so you wanted to go where?
Yahoo Groups, second. The thing about Yahoo Groups, you use it to send information out for when you update your video blog, but groups can be used, set up by anyone for anything. And I have one set up for Aries, but I'm also a member of about 20 different ones. The thing about groups is that you can the notification is what can kill you. If you say notify me every time there's an update, your email will start filling up very quickly. But on every one of these things, you can set the group so that it does not email you, it doesn't notify you at all, and you just have to pop over here, you know, once a week or something, and see what's up in the news group that you care about. But if you're on using Bofung, or if you're using a Yaesu VX8, there's a news group for virtually every radio, and it's really a great idea to join those where you have a radio, and just look through the messages, and you'll see see quite a bit of interesting information, a lot of Q&A. That's a cool...
I was thinking that was your Slits ad again, but it's not. Yeah. It's just similar art.
It's not. That's really neat.
Yeah, that's the 60-meter group. I've, as you can see over here, I follow a lot. Well, and they're not even all listed over here. But I was going to try to find the place where I set my membership, but I'm not... And I know it can be done. I just don't know where to go to do it, to turn off.
Yeah, I think it's over on the left underneath your group's home at the bottom. It's called Manage Your Groups.
Ah, okay.
Then you can put them in the order that you want. There you go. You can put them in the order that you want to display them. Special notices means only if it's really important, which is deemed by poster, individual emails. See. So you do want to get the emails if somebody sends to your ham radio now. But
yeah. So for the most part, I've got things set for special notices for most of the groups that I'm in. They also have a daily digest that'll aggregate everything and send it once.
Yeah, that's great. That's great for groups that you care about. I get that for Echo Link and IRLP and so forth. The North Texas Aries group uses Yahoo groups for all their... for all their information, and they have a files area also that's quite useful to post files similar to Dropbox, except it's restricted to group members only. So that's what I use for Aries. All of our forms are in there and so forth. So why don't you pull up aprs.fi for just a second, Gary? And
and when I punch this up, it's going to have you right in the middle of it.
Oh yeah, there's my mobile. That's my shot over to Whole Foods and back. So aprs.fi is amateur radio and GPS, essentially. And as you zoom in and out, you'll see all sorts of activity. Some of this has all happened within the last few minutes, some within a day or so. You've got tracker on for me, so you could see where I was driving. I have a Kenwood D 700 in my car, which beacons a packet every 2 minutes. So some real interesting stuff that you can do, though, here. If you click on station information over on the right, Gary, in other views, scroll down a little bit. Up a little bit where it says station. There you go, station info. This is very interesting stuff because it tells you the location, the last position, the course, the speed. It also says who is near me and who has heard me. So we have a digipeater at Gun Barrel City, and this is a way that I can tell how well it's working because it tells me who's close, but I also like stations which heard me directly, stations which heard my digipeater directly. So that's pretty cool. And you can click on all of those. You can sort any of the rows and columns. You can see who heard me directly, and I'm running 50 watts in my car. But you can see the distance there. And if you click on that TX equals RX, I believe it will show me the furthest person, furthest station that heard me in the last 24 hours or so was 38 miles away. That's not too bad for mobile in Dallas.
For 2 meters, that's pretty good because there's no repeaters involved in this.
Yes, because this is the directly. Now, you know, APRS uses digipeters all the time, but this particular function right here is saying who heard me directly and what date and time. So you'll see band openings and so forth. It's quite interesting, especially if you click on a digipeter and see what's up. You'll see sometimes 200-300 mile paths.
I'm not sure what that is I just clicked on, but let's see. Yeah, it's also a good way to tell if a band is open, and there are some sites out there that use that data.
Yeah, that is the Digipeter in Kaufman County. That's about 40 miles south of Dallas.
Yeah, so the farthest station that's seen them directly is 198 miles, almost 200 miles away.
And you can, I think there's typically information at the top that tells you where the station's located, how much power they're running, how high they are. I guess in this case it doesn't. You can decode the PHG and tell.
Yeah.
Anyway, APRS is pretty cool. Had a lot of fun with that over the years. I've got a mobile and a weather station. It's not connected right now to it. Next website is eham.net, which I really enjoy, especially there's a lot of news stories here. The thing that's terrific about eham.net is their reviews. I will not buy anything without reading all of the reviews about an item. So the reviews are going to be on the left, up just a skosh, I think. There, reviews. And again, this is user-generated content. So if you set up a free account on here, if you scroll down a little bit, Gary, you'll see there's categories. Pretty much everything. There's like for Yagi's, there's 416 different items. So click on any one of those, like the, and go inside for a second.
Yeah, let me find something that is kind of common.
How about weather radios? That's pretty interesting. I posted something in weather radios a while back.
Got weather stations.
Okay, it must have been in receivers, weather radio. Click on weather stations for a second, though. So I want to show you something there. Because we're going to talk about this in a second. You'll see that there's the product on the left. There's a number of reviews, the average rating, 1 to 5, the last time it was reviewed, and the MSRP, which may or may not be accurate. But if you click on any one of those, like scroll down just a skosh to the Davis, one of the Davis ones, Davis Vantage Pro Wireless, right there. Okay, so that's one of the weather stations that I have at the lake. In fact, I'm still number one there. So what you give it a review, 1 to 5, and then follow up if it changes. And you'll, in fact, see people say, boy, this is great. Then after 6 months, oh, you know, I changed my mind. It's not a 5, it's a 3. But for any piece of equipment, old, new, definitely, I would highly recommend you use eham.net. Post reviews of the things that you have that you like. Post reviews of the things that you have that you don't like. But it's really a valuable resource.
Yeah, and after you read them a little bit, you can tell if somebody knows what they're talking about. Unfortunately, well, people will get on there who are just blithering idiots and spew. But you get the idea pretty quick that.
Well, when you read a 5x5 and they say, I just put it up this week and I just love it. Okay, yeah. Well, yeah. But when you read something that's, I've had this up for 15 years and it's still running fine.
Yeah.
That's where you know you've got a winner.
And they put a column in there for how long have you had it, which is useful information because you can't get good information from somebody who's had it a month.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, let's see. We've got a one here for amateur radio with the r2rs.com. And the reason I want to bring that up is this is another one I found through Feedly, but it's there's a lot of interesting articles in amateurradio.com, including several different contributors that write about getting involved with ham radio and working on your license. So there's definitely an international flair to this one. There's folks from around the world that contribute. Of course, a lot of ads on the right to try and pay for the band space. But pretty interesting stuff. One of the guys that I bumped into, I believe through amateurradio.com, is KB6NU.com. And he has his own website, Kilo Bravo 6 November Uniform.com. And very good writer.
Let me point out here that I am one of the amateurradio.com contributors. They invited me on last year.
Cool.
I don't get on there a lot. I don't put a lot of stuff on there, but a lot of the broadcasters just put their show announcements up there. I don't do that. If I'm going to put something up there, it'll probably be a show announcement, but it'll probably have stuff beyond what you see in the show and more than just an announcement. So I take a little bit of time to put something in there.
Oh, that's great.
Who is that you wanted to see?
Kilo Bravo 6, novemberuniform.com.
Okay.
And what's interesting here, I ran into him again through Feedly, but he has a book out, a couple of different books on helping newcomers with ham radio. And he'll have, like right now, a question and answer about a general class question and a little bit of information on it. He also has some real interesting blog posts just on his ham radio activities. A very good writer. That I ran into through, originally through DX Zone and then, then radio, amateurradio.com, and then decided to add him specifically to my Feedly. So I see whenever he updates. Next one I wanted to mention was radioreference.com. If you, have a scanner, this is definitely a website that you're going to want to use. It's a free service, but, there's some reasons, I kick in every year to help support this. It's grown terrifically. It used to just be public service, police, fire bands, but he has added amateur radio in the past couple of years. So you can click on databases, and I would click on frequency database, because that's, I think, what most folks would care about. And then click on a state. Click on a county, and then you'll see all the scanner frequencies for that county. And the police and fire folks are pretty good, actually, about adding them if you click on the license, you'll actually see more information about it, which is pretty interesting.
Okay, so you. State. All this stuff is public, you know, it's in the FCC database, but there are the actual transmitter locations.
Yeah, isn't that neat?
Yeah, that's very cool.
And some of the more expensive scanners, actually, you can download a file from Radio Reference and pop it right in. So I know Radio Shack was a contributor to RadioReference.com. I hope somebody else will come in and pick that up. But and it's really neat that they've added ham repeaters also. I think that's really useful information.
Yeah, I have a program for my GRE scanner that has a tie into Radio Reference. You can see most of the Radio Reference stuff for free, but if you want to use some of their online database stuff, you need to be a contributor, which I think is like $30 a year. That's fairly reasonable. But so this program lets you just fill everything in automatically sucking it in from their database. You still got to punch a lot of buttons and be real specific about what stuff you want to put in, or you're going to fill thousands of frequencies into a scanner. But it's kind of automated that way. So,
yeah, that's neat. Yeah, that's another one that I send money to every year, because that's a service. Well, it's been great to watch it grow the last few years.
Yep. I'm logged in here, so I've been a contributor for a long time.
Yeah. The other one I wanted to mention is repeaterbook.com. I know there's a lot of ways to look up repeaters, but this repeaterbook.com is, again, a user-maintained, user-generated content database on the Internet. And the cool thing here is you can add the information about your repeater. You can show if it's active or not. You can search by frequency. You can search by proximity to your home and so forth. It's really great when you're traveling to use it on your tablet or on your phone. They've added Echo Link, so you can check on Echo Link. But if you just click on the repeater database there, and then you kind of just burrow down into your specific area.
Let's look at some repeaters by you someplace. So we're going to go to Texas.
And Now, it's interesting here. So you can see it by feature. You can see it by length. If you're interested in the North Central Texas connection, or see, there's a whole bunch of different length systems within Texas. Or you can do it by DMR, or you can do it by D-Star. If you scroll down just a skosh more, Gary, you'll find what I think is very interesting. You can do it by Aries or Races. You can also do it if along I-20 or I-30. These are major interstates that cross through Texas. So it'll tell you if you're going to be driving down I-30 from west to east Texas, you know, what repeaters are going to be in range. That's really cool. And then, of course, if you you can click on location. So if you scroll down and click on Dallas,
one of those that sets things across horizontally, which makes it impossible for me to follow them.
Yeah.
There's Dallas. That's going to be big.
So here it's going to be by frequency, but I believe that's clickable. And you see we mostly use 110.9 here in Dallas. The little green dot tells you that it's been verified as being opened by a user recently.
Interesting.
And each one of those on the left-hand side is clickable, and it'll give you more information about that specific repeater. So, for instance, if you click on 146.88, which is one of the big repeaters here in Dallas, you'll see that it's got Echo Link and also is Racy's. Good coverage north of downtown. Coverage gets poorer. So someone's put that in. 200 feet, 70 watts, closed auto patch. It's Echo Link. Is there. It's available. It's on idle. There's some information on their nets. And the good thing is if you put a comment.
That's who I am
there,
on Facebook. I'm not sure why.
Need to change your feed picture. You can see that K2DMS is the contributor that added the tone squelch information. And they also have a feed. I guess you can listen live there. So this is really cool. I mean, there's a bunch of ways to look up repeaters, but I really like the idea of repeaterbook.com. It's a user-generated content. I put that in my Feedly for a while, and there were repeaters being updated like every hour or two countrywide. So I took that out of my RSS feed pretty quickly.
Yep. This part here, let's see, did I put, yeah, there we go. This column here with the open, with the red dot and green dot is particularly interesting because I've never seen this site before. And it's one of the idea is one of the things that is most irritating about just about every repeater database. And that is that there are so many repeaters in them that aren't on the air. Paper repeaters, but repeaters that have coordination, they show up in the ARL repeater directory and just about every other repeater directory, but they're not on the air. Maybe because they broke yesterday, but in a lot of cases, because they went down years ago and the guy keeps filing the coordination because it's hard to get coordination. He doesn't want to lose it. Some repeater groups are starting to try to kick repeaters off coordination for that, but it's a real mess. So this is cool. If it's really accurate, it'll tell you whether something's going to be on the air or not. Do you know if this has any links to any of the programming software, like the RT programming system? I don't think it does.
No, I don't believe so. But it does have a terrific iPad app, which I use.
Okay, so you can look things up as you're on the road.
Yeah,
that's cool. Yep. The one I've used the most lately is R-Finder, which does have a connection. So Radio Reference also has a connection into the RT Systems programming software. The Radio Reference for ham repeaters is still pretty limited.
Right.
The R-Finder has been pretty good, except it's, once again, littered with repeaters that have that aren't on the air. So.
Right. Sure.
Of limited utility, but if you dump in a bunch and you start clicking them as you're driving through an area and they don't come up, well, okay, next. It's easy to go to the next one and find one on the air.
That's right. Let's see, a couple I wanted to talk about with weather. Weather Underground is a service that I used back when the internet was first starting and it was text only. You could put in a zip code or something like that or a state and get something back a minute or two later on the interweb. But the Weather Underground is now owned by Weather Channel. I was afraid they would mess it up, but I think they've actually put some money in the bucket. They've really improved their service. But There's a couple of things about Weather Underground I wanted to point out. If you go ahead and just put in your zip code if you want, or just put, put your zip code in there.
Oops, I can't use the number pad. That's what does the switching. Okay, 27513. Sorry about making everybody dizzy there for a moment. We have California weather today. The humidity is very low, and it's a little windy, so that's what this special statement is all about. It's warning everybody that we have fire danger around here.
So if you set up an account, and again, I believe the account is free, you can put a little, see the star there? You can make that a favorite, so it pops, that becomes your favorite station. And you can also click on home and make it your home station. You can also click on change station and find the one closest to your house.
Okay, I think I must have an account, but I don't know what it is because I've actually used this on my tablet. When it appeared that the Weather Channel, which I'd had on my tablet, was a battery hog. And that'll come and go. But so I put this on, and it was listed. I was familiar with them for a long time, but it was listed as one of the most battery forgiving applications for a phone or tablet. So,
right,
that's how they ended up there. They seem to work pretty well.
What I don't see on the PC is a thing called Wonder Map. And it's called Full View, I think, on the PC. But it brings up a map. Click on Map for a second. You might be able to.
Oh, there's something that says Wonder Map.
Well, there you go. So this is really cool. And right now it doesn't look that great, except go ahead and click Weather Stations over on the right in the blocks. And that will bring up Personal Weather Stations. Now this becomes really interesting because you can see the fronts move through. You can see the winds move around. And this is updating in real time.
So these are all personal weather stations.
Yes.
Around my area. And I guess with the direction that the wind is pointing, indicating that summer whacked.
Isn't that wild? You can turn different layers on. Now when I look at it, I get about 100 different options on the right. So I think you might have to log in to get all these other options. But it's you can do ultraviolet layers. I really like the weather stations one because and you can zoom in, you can save it. I have that on my homepage at Cedar Creek Lake. We have a bunch of hams that have set up weather stations, and it allows you to see what's up. But you can actually watch the fronts come through. The temperatures are color-coded if they're in the 70s. If you zoom farther back to where it's cooler, you'll see the colors on the weather stations will change.
Yeah, we're having a heat wave here, by the way.
Yeah, I can see that. And you're seeing the radar.
Yeah, so there's our cold zone. Sorry, Milwaukee, 31 degrees. It's 71 down here in North Carolina.
So the other thing you can do when you're a member is you can set up weather alerts. And I guess a lot of the TV and radio stations allow you to do that. But what Weather Underground allows you, gives you about 40 different states that from weather service feeds. And you can say, I want to get a text if there's a warning, but an email if there's a watch, that kind of thing. So I believe it's $10 a year to be a member. But if you set up a weather station, then it's free for life because you're then feeding weather in. And what I like about this is that I've set my alerts up so that I get the different kinds of alerts for different types of watches and warnings. And you can also have several different email accounts. I think it allows you to use up to 5 different email accounts. So I set the different notifications up for my wife and different notifications to go to my Aries account. So this is where Weather Underground, I think it's really very cool. And even if it costs you $10 a year, it's worth it. But I also encourage you guys to set up a weather station of your own. It's the cost on these has dropped a lot. There's a company that I really like called, Ambient Weather is the name of the company, ambientweather.com. they're a commercial outfit that sells weather instruments for home use and for commercial use. And they've come a long way. I've been following them. They have this thing called the Ambient Weather Observer. There it is right there. They've dropped the price on this thing. I also have one of those alert radios, which is very cool. It's got weather radio built in. They've got a lot of really interesting weather stations. But this, if you click on that observer, you'll see that there's different options from less expensive to more. The cool thing is the weather station that I have, which is I've had for a long time from Davis, requires a PC to be connected all the time to it in order to send stuff to the internet. This has dropped the price where you can actually set something up on your roof, point it to your router, and it'll go right to the internet. It doesn't require a PC. And I think the $150 version, you don't even have a console. You just use your iPad or your Android phone, or you get the information back from Weather Underground rather than directly from the device. But just for $150, you can have a weather station on your roof that's really cool and add weather to the Weather Underground. What I recommend when you set up your Weather Underground station, there is an option to title it the way you want. We've encouraged folks at the lake to put their subdivision and then dash their call sign so that the amateur radio gets a little bit of a plug. And we've added about six different weather stations hosted by ham operators down at Cedar Creek Lake here in Texas. And it's kind of fun. It gives a little bit of visibility to ham radio. But several folks have set up this ambient weather station, and they're quite happy with it. I'm real happy to see the prices on these things come down. You can pay a lot of money for them, but take a look at what your needs are. But again, it's a really cool service. And once it's on Weather Underground, of course, you can use it on your own blog. You can use it in a bunch of different applications.
No, it's solar powered too.
Yeah, it's solar powered. That's amazing for the price.
You could stick that up on your roof and not have to run any kind of wire up to it. Power or data.
Right. You just connect it. There's a receiver at your router to the internet. Just plug it in there and it goes from there.
That makes it easy.
Yep. I started with my first wired one with Pete Brothers years and years ago. Switched to wireless, and it's cool to have a weather station at your house. I really enjoy it. And our POAs enjoy it because they can say, we have our own weather station here in our neighborhood.
POAs?
A property owners association. One of the good things about a POA.
Yeah. Boo. Yes.
So let's see. Winding down here, I did want to mention if your club does not have a club website, please set one up. I mean, this is how folks are going to find you. I have used a lot of different services over time, but I use WordPress.com. WordPress has been around for a long time, too. There's two versions of WordPress. WordPress.com is hosted, so you don't have to do anything except ask for an account. That's how I'm using it. If you like RichCasey.net, RichCasey.com, K5CCL.org is the club website at Cedar Creek. Yeah, you always type a 4. I always type a 5.
I turn everybody into a 4.
There
okay,
you
so
go.
That's a WordPress site. WordPress doesn't show up anywhere.
Right, except at the very, very bottom. You can set up multiple pages, as you see there. It's got an RSS feed. You can have, you can see the stats, see how many people are logging in. It automatically takes your articles, and you can archive them, keep as many as you want on there. You can have photos. It's really a great, great tool. And I like the idea that that you can automatically have an RSS feed. Now, if you have access to a server and somebody that's technically inclined, WordPress.org allows you to download their software and do a lot more stuff with it. But this way with .com, you can have multiple folks helping host it. You don't have to worry about the back end. All you need to worry about is the content. So
there's the WordPress.org website.
Yeah.
So that's where you get the actual program.
Yeah. And once you download it, you got to figure out where to put it. And it's not that difficult to do. I just would rather have it hosted for me. The other one I found recently is a site called rainedout.net. This is a free site that allows you to set up SMS app text messaging to a group. And the really cool thing here is, again, it's free. And for if you have an Aries notification list, this is a great way to do it. Set it up under, like I have Henderson County Aries, and you can have an admin or two that has access to be able to push out the messages. So when there's weather moving into the area, you can use raindout.net to notify all your folks that come up on the net. So again, that's really a nice service for free. And for clubs, of course, we use Yahoo Groups for a lot, and we, for a lot of our information posting. And of course, we use Dropbox for file access. So there's no reason for your club not to have an active internet presence. I really really encourage clubs to do that and post far in advance that you're going to have a new ham class and bring some more folks back into the hobby.
There is such a variety of ways that clubs have used and maintained it. I find very few clubs that don't have a website, but I find a lot that have a website that hasn't been touched in 6 years.
Right.
There was a period of time when I was editing a local magazine, regional magazine, and one of the things I had to do was go gather up information on hamfests for a hamfest calendar, and it was like pulling teeth to get information out of these radio clubs. They were deliberately hiding themselves.
Yeah, that's crazy. It
could have been so much better for them.
Yep, yep.
They could have had people coming to their hamfest.
Well, and bringing new folks into the hobby.
That too.
That's the main thing. But there's just the more technical you get with these websites, the harder it is to find somebody when you don't want to be admin anymore. I've done the same thing with a bunch of different clubs. Now I think about, well, when I get tired of this, how can I get someone else to do it? And that's where a tool like WordPress.com instead of WordPress.org, where you just need to find someone that doesn't mind being an editor as opposed to find somebody that wants to be a sysadmin. It's a whole different skill level.
That is true. Just about anything that a radio club does, if it's been the passion of one person and they set up a lot of infrastructure, passing it on can be a problem. Even repeaters are that way. We're probably about to go through a period of 10 years where people that built repeaters are now getting either too old to maintain them or they just die. And they don't have anybody, no line of succession. So
repeaters and lots of other parts. Regular ham classes and bring folks in to take over so you can sit back and talk rather than have to head down to the repeater site.
Yeah, but either allow them to or strongly arm them into taking on these functions. A local club that I've been part of for a long time does not have a Hamfest chairman this year. The old Hamfest chairman said he couldn't do it, and no one stepped up to be the next one. So they've sort of got a committee-ish group of people that are sort of doing it, and it's going to happen, but it's not going to be as well organized as the one guy. So
yeah.
Again, we're getting to that point where aging out. Ham Radio Now has got no one to take over. When I'm gone, the show is over. You know, but that's not that big a deal. But we're not something that is got to be here forever. You don't want your radio club to go because some key person can't do it.
Yeah, it's interesting. The Dallas Club, I think, just had their 75th anniversary, something like that. I mean, they've been around a long time. So you see clubs come and go. The good ones add value and bring the next generation on. But I think what I found in all the volunteer work that I've done, Gary, if it's really important and providing a service, somebody will step up. Otherwise, if it's only you holding up the banner, then it's time for it to go.
That could be the case. As we age, don't replace ourselves. We're going to see that a little bit more often. Anything else that we need to go take a look at before we go?
No, I think that's we've probably see if we still have an audience at the end.
15% of the people who started watching are still watching. Congratulations,
cool.
15%.
We appreciate that.
It's about the way it was with all of my long shows. The audience dwindles off toward the end, but a few folks say, I watch every show and I watch all the way to the end. So good on you.
We appreciate it.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I appreciate it. This has been some pretty cool stuff. I knew a lot of what you were showing, but I didn't know all the details. But there were several pieces that I am going to have to follow up on and go learn more about. So, and I'm sure everybody who's in that status, they knew a lot of the stuff, but there's a few things in there that say, oh, yeah, I got to go get that. So.
Yeah, great. Well, good to talk to you again, and we appreciate the audience hanging in there with us.
Yep.
Let's do it again sometime, Gary.
Yes, well, we'll call and talk and not have a recording going on so we can be more informal because we've got a lot of old stuff to catch up on.
Yep, that's right. That's right.
All right, thanks, Richie. Remember how this ends now. I get to say I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Rich Casey, N5CSU.
Over.
And out.
Stare straight into the camera for a moment and that logo fades in.